Welcome to Nobody Told Me. I'm Jan Black.
And I'm Laura Owens.
Our guest on this episode is Reshma Saujani, the founder and CEO of the nonprofit Girls Who Code, which aims to close the gender gap in STEM fields and encourage girls to explore computer programming.
Reshma feels girls need to learn to take risks and not fear failure rather than pursue perfection in all things. Her new book is called Brave, Not Perfect, Fear Less, Fail More, and Live Bolder. Reshma, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me.
So tell us what inspired that book, Brave, Not Perfect.
Yeah, well, you know, I feel like I've been working on women and girls issues for the past 30 years of my life. And when I looked at kind of the state of women when I was 13, and then I looked at it when I was 43, it felt like nothing had really changed. And I spent my life with teenage girls, and I started looking at, you know, how they were learning code as like an indication of like how they were struggling so much with perfectionism. And, you know, I feel like in the time that girls are little, they're taught to be perfect, and we raise our boys to be brave. And in many ways, like, they get addicted to this perfectionism, right? And they feel like if there's they make a mistake or something comes hard to them, that it immediately means that they shouldn't do it. And what's happening is we're creating, you know, a generation of young women who, quite frankly, are not happy. And we're also creating a leadership gap.
So why is this new generation of women not happy?
Well, I don't even, you know, arguably, I don't even know if it's this generation or if it's just all of us. Because I think that we've been sold a bill of goods that if we're perfect, we'll be happy. That if we're polished, we'll be happy. And we get opportunities that come to us. And if we think that they're hard or that they don't come to us easily, we pass on them. And we let our great ideas die on the vine. And then we see other people, right, who do the thing we thought we should have done, and they succeed. And it creates so much regret and envy. And I think it creates so much unhappiness. And I believe that, like, bravery is joy, right? When you do something brave, you feel joyful.
I agree. And it's really about the journey, not so much if you end up getting to where you want to be, but the fact that you ended up being brave in the first place. And that leads me to wanting to know more about how you were brave when you ran for Congress. Talk to us about how you first got that idea and the process and the outcome.
Yeah. So, like, I was this perfect immigrant daughter, right? I got straight A's, always listened to my parents, went to the schools I should have gone to, had the jobs that I should have gone to. And I kind of woke up at 33 and I was like, why aren't I happy? And I was coming home every day from a job I hated, right? But I was, quote, good at. And I was miserable. And, you know, deep in my heart, ever since the time I was a little girl, like, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I wanted to serve. But I was too scared to run for office. And I watched Hillary Clinton give this kind of her first concession speech. And she had this line where she said, you know, just because I failed doesn't mean you shouldn't try too. And I swore she was speaking to me. So at 33, I decided to run for Congress, you know, against someone who had been there for 18 years. I swore that I could win. I could shake every hand. That did not happen. I lost miserably. I was broke. I was humiliated. I had pissed off everybody in the Democratic establishment. And, like, I had no contingency plan. And yes, I cried a lot, you know, for like a month, right? Uh-huh. Drank a lot of margaritas.
Of course.
but you know what? It didn't break me. And that was a surprise to me because I had thought before then that, like, if I failed at something, especially something that's so public as running for office, that it would literally break me and I wouldn't be able to get up from the ground. And that's when I started realizing that, like, bravery is like a muscle. Right? You just got to keep exercising it over and over and over again.
So what do we need to do in society to make young girls and young women and women in general more brave?
Well, I think we have to, I mean, I have a couple strategies. So the first thing I say is I think we have to start practicing imperfection. And, like, an example of that is, you know, I tell women, send an email with a typo in it. And everyone's like, what? You want me to do what? Because think about almost every woman I know spends hours rereading and rereading and rereading emails when we should be doing something else, right? And what the fact of the matter is like, if we send an email with a typo in it, like, it doesn't matter. No one's going to think that we're an idiot. We're not going to lose our jobs. You know what I mean? Our dreams are not going to die. Like, it's going to be fine. And so we have to start practicing imperfection, whatever that thing is for you. And the second thing is I think we have to start doing things that we suck at. you know, and not for the sake of getting good at them, but for knowing what it feels like to just be mediocre, to just get a B, right? For me, I've been learning how to surf, even though I'm scared of water and I'm really bad at it. You know, I barely ever get my 2 feet on the board, but it feels good to like try something new and to feel challenged and to just be proud of myself that I didn't give up before I tried.
And you talk about how being brave is addictive. What's the science behind that?
Because I think being brave is like joyful.
I agree. And it makes you grittier, you know, like you do something and you don't do well at it. And you do kind of feel like, well, I can take another hit again. I'll try again.
Exactly. I mean, that's literally how I felt after I ran for office. And I'm not saying it didn't hurt, because it hurts when things don't work out.
Right.
But I felt good. I felt like I had control over my life anymore. I felt like I wasn't going to be that 85-year-old woman sitting in a rocking chair and just bitter because she didn't pursue her dreams. And I think that that's really what it's about. Like, you know, I have friends who have been trying to write a book. And when they see other people becoming these, you know, famous authors, if they're in the process of writing, they don't feel so bad about themselves. You know, one of my favorite stories is this woman I met. She was trying out for the Olympics, and she was a diver. And it was like her last Olympic trial. She gets up, she does her dive. She does not happen, right? It's over for her. Her boyfriend's sitting there and he's like, all right, it's over. Let's go. And she goes, no, give me a minute. And she climbs up and she does the perfect dive. And she's like, I did that for me. Like, I knew the consequences weren't going to change. I wasn't going to the Olympics, but I did that for me.
Isn't it human nature really to pursue the things at which we excel instead of pursuing the things in which we're uncomfortable and not confident? And how do we get away from that?
See, I don't think it's human nature. I think it's the way we've raised our girls. Because, you know, from the time that they're young, we've wanted to protect and coddle them. Like, I think our nature is from the time the girls are little to like, I want to keep you safe. I don't want your feelings to be hurt. So like when we put our daughters into gymnastics and they can't do a cartwheel, instead of hearing them come home and cry every day, we put them into swimming or we put them into dance, something that they can do good at. Whereas with our boys, it's different, because I think we're trying to teach them how to be fearless, how to be risk takers. All of us have a man in our life, you know, who's horrible at golf or sucks at basketball, but he doesn't care. He keeps getting out there on the court. He keeps getting out there, right, doing his 18 holes, and because he enjoys it. It doesn't matter if he's not good at it. I know very few women who pursue like extracurricular activities or hobbies that they're quote not good at, because it makes them feel bad. And I think that's what we have to change, right? This feeling of like when you're in when I'm in my Beyonce dance class and I'm like, everybody else is just like looking awesome and I'm kind of, you know, but I'm having fun.
Right.
You know what I mean? I'm enjoying it.
Can you explain why this was in the book, and I just loved it, about psychologist Carol Dweck's research about how fifth graders handled an assignment? I related to this so much personally, and I really want you to share it with our audience.
Well, one of my favorite lines from her is she says, you know, if life were one long grade school, like girls would run the world. You know? And, I think that, and it's so true, but it's not.
Straight A's all day.
Right. And she was the one who kind of also famously said, like, women will apply for a job if they meet 100% of the qualifications, and men will apply when they meet 60%.
Mm-hmm.
And so, again, I think when girls are working on something and it doesn't come to them right away, they go straight to, I suck. I'm not good at this. I'm a failure, right? And not that like, well, let me keep working on it. Whereas boys are like, oh, I got that piece right. You know what I mean? Like, I'm doing great. And it's this frame of reference where we immediately go to this dark place. And some of the other research I have in the book, and it starts happening around 8, where that kind of critic, you know, starts appearing in our heads. And it's normally at that time where in school girls start getting grades, right? And so they start getting graded for things. And so that they then associate that with things that they're good at or bad at, right? That fixed mindset or that growth mindset.
Our conversation on Nobody Told Me will be right back, but we wanted to let you know about a recent discovery of ours. You know, there's nothing like a good speech to inspire and motivate us to be the best we can be. Well, we recently found a pretty cool podcast that does just that.
Aaron Falconer and Jeremy Fisher over at the Pick the Brain podcast listen to and discuss speeches, articles, and interviews from people like Ellen DeGeneres, Will Smith, Tim Ferriss, and J.K. Rowling.
Check out their podcast wherever you're listening to our show.
It's called the Pick the Brain podcast. Again, it's the Pick the Brain podcast.
Check it out. So how is this need to be perfect holding girls back?
Well, I think it's just, I think, one, preventing them from being exposed to things that they may like, but not necessarily be good at. You know, secondly, I think it's making them become perfectionists. And that's not what we reward in the real world. You know, one of the studies I talk about in the book is that, you know, when young women declare a major in college, you know, if they don't get an A in the introductory class and they get a B, they normally drop it. Whereas men don't do that. They're like, oh, I got a B. So it's having real consequences on the things that we want to be doing and should be doing. And I think in many ways, it's causing the leadership gap in this country.
So what's your very best advice to inspire somebody who's maybe been a perfectionist their whole life?
Well, I talked about practice imperfection, do something you suck at. You know, three, just start, right? Just start. Take one step. You know, the thing is, I believe that you can unlearn perfectionism. I think you can learn to be brave, not perfect. And that doesn't mean that you're not going to fall on and off the wagon. But when you start kind of one, stop that toxic people-pleasing behavior that all of us do, right? When we get bumped into in the coffee shop and we say sorry, even though they bumped into us, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm. I so relate to that.
No, you know,
yeah.
when we don't say no, when we don't have time for the things that people need from us. I mean, I always say like, after I was pregnant, I just could not lose the baby weight. And I felt so bad every time I took a photo or I was, you know, and I needed to just be able to have that time to go exercise. And it had to be for me at 7:30 in the morning because I had this job and I need to be at work, you know, by 9:30. And I just felt guilty. I felt guilty not taking the dog out. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I felt guilty not waking up with the baby and feeding him breakfast. I had so much guilt that I didn't even have the courage to do something for myself. That's the kind of bravery that I'm talking about. Every day bravery. And if you just for 1 week, and we've been doing these bravery challenges and with some of my friends and family, and it's like all of them tell, you know, within a week, it's like they're approaching life differently.
What are your thoughts on how girls pressure other girls to be perfect?
Yeah, I mean, it's so much worse than social media. I mean, girls are constantly scrolling, you know, through, you know, their Instagram pages to see how many likes they have. I mean, when I did focus groups with girls, many of them had two Instagram accounts, one for their real life, you know, and one for the life that they wanted other people to see that they have. You know, I tease my niece, she's like 16 years old, and if she takes a photo and she doesn't get at least 500 likes, she deletes the post.
Oh, wow.
She's like deleting a memory, right?
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. It's sad. And so I think it's really, really, really exacerbating this perfectionism and this sense of like, well, everyone else has it going exactly right. And why am I such a mess? Which is why I think, and I talk about this in the book, it's so important to show kind of the mess behind the scenes. You know, don't take a selfie picture 500 times before you post it. Men don't do that.
So then do you think that women have regressed and are not as brave in this high-tech age, a lot in part because of social media?
I think social media is definitely playing a role and is like exacerbating this sense of kind of anxiety and perfectionism, definitely. And I think that there's a lot of great literature out there that really supports that.
Yeah, like no women are going to post a video of themselves going to a dance class and sucking. Even though that's a brave thing to do, nobody's going to do that.
Nope. But we need to. I've been doing these Failure Fridays on Instagram and it's been fun. You know, like I show my mess behind the scenes. And it's really amazing because like if you have this hashtag brave not perfect on Instagram, you just scroll through it. It's like women basically showing the mess behind the scenes, right? Them like rock climbing and falling. You know what I mean? Then struggling like with what they messed up. You know, I had this one little girl write me this open letter on Medium 2 days ago, you know, about how she signed up for computer science and she just, you know, isn't doing well, but she's not going to give up. Right. And it's hard for her because it feels like everybody's like, oh, this was so easy. This was so great. Like, I got an A. And so the more you practice, I think, risk-taking and failing, and again, the authenticity, you know, in the fact that it's not easy to you, the easier it becomes.
But that's why I think that authenticity is so important, and that we do try and show ourselves not being perfect on social media, since that's largely where we're able to show who we really are. I think it's really inspirational for women to be showing that you can be successful and you don't need to be perfect and, you know, editing your selfie for 2 hours before you post it, that you can be a real woman, and that's inspirational too.
Yeah. Or editing your life. I mean, life is hard. Like, you know, more kind of shitty things happen to you than good things, you know, on most days, right? And it's like, if you're constantly making it look like it's so great, it also makes you feel really bad because you feel like you're living this really fake life. And I don't even think it's just girls. Like, I think it's a lot of women our age, right? Mm-hmm. And you see it on Facebook.
We've mentioned that you're the founder and CEO of the nonprofit Girls Who Code, which aims to encourage girls to explore computer programming. Tell us a little bit more about the challenges that girls face in computer science careers these days.
Yeah, you know, we forget, like, the world's first programmer was a woman, you know, Ada Lovelace. Like, you had all Katherine Johnson, the ENIAC women. So, like, if you walked into a gaming camp in America in the 1980s, it pretty much would have been half boys, half girls. And then in the 80s, 90s, 2000s, you've had a steady decline. And so today it's less than 18%, less than 20%. Our technology workforce is female. And that's happening at a time where, you know, 40% of America's breadwinners are women. And every day you read a story about another industry that's being automated by technology. Mm-hmm. But women are being left behind. And so in 2012, I was like, this doesn't make sense. Like, what's happening here? And so I started just a summer program, you know, that I hosted at a friend's company, and I picked 20 girls and we taught them how to code. And many of them walked away from that experience being like, this is what I want to do with my life. And so I realized that, like, we're doing a poor job, right, of, like, showing girls what you can make and create through code. And that, like, we can actually close the gender gap in technology if we commit to it. And so now, 6 years later, we've taught over 185,000 girls by the end of 2019 in all 50 states. We're going global. I'm so proud. Like, when I go into computer science departments across the country, like, those are my girls. Like, I have no doubt, you know, by 2027 that we will close the gender gap in computer science and technology. And that means that, like, you're going to have girls who, like, find a cure to cancer, mm-hmm. you know, who do something about climate change, you know, who are going to make sure that all the future artificial intelligence and data sets don't exclude us. Because it's really scary kind of what's happening right now and how important it is for women and for people of color to be part of the conversation.
What are some more of the really concrete steps that we need to take to decrease that gender gap and close it?
Well, I think, you know, on a day-to-day level for every parent that's listening, you know, who might have a young kid, like, let your girls get their hands dirty. You know, teach them how to take things apart and to put them together. Don't let them tell you that they're bad at math and science just because it comes to them. It doesn't come easy to them. It doesn't come easy to anyone. You know, encourage them to stick with it. Take them to maker fairs. And then as soon as you can, get them enrolled in a coding class. You know, teach them how to be a computational thinker. And, you know, make sure that your public school districts, you know, go to your PTA meetings, like, make sure that they're teaching our kids this. We cannot let our children be left behind. You know, President Obama once said, like, the last jobs to go will be the humans telling the computers what to do. And I think that is absolutely right.
What obstacles do women face these days if they are interested in a computer science career?
Yeah, I think it's hard being the only one, right? There's so few of us right now that it feels very isolating. That's what happens when every teacher tells me that. Like, I have three girls in my computer science class, and then they drop out because they're the only one. So we need to make a real effort to make sure that we're creating and cultivating sisterhood, you know, amongst the girls that are there and encouraging more to join. And that's what we do at Girls Who Code. You know, I think the second thing is there are a lot of microaggressions that happen both in the classroom and in technology, in tech companies. And so we got to get that sexism out. of these industries. You know, we can't be having $1 million payouts, you know, for men who've been accused of sexual harassment. Since, you know, it's horrible. And so we have to be like focused about making sure that we have these cultures change at these companies.
So why is it so important that girls try and learn how to code rather than do traditional activities that girls might learn, like how to dance? Because when I was growing up, and I mean, it wasn't like it was that long ago, there just weren't opportunities to learn how to do something like coding. And honestly, I wish there had been.
Yeah, I don't think it's either or. I think it's yes and please.
Be more dynamic.
I mean, it's funny. It's like if you watch a Beyonce video, there's a lot of technology that goes into that. You better believe that she is sitting right next to her, you know, her technologist and being like, make that, do that. Uh-huh. And so you would be surprised how much coding is in fashion, is in art, is in entertainment, is in law, is in medicine, is in everything. And so to me, it's like reading and writing. It's just a skill you are just going to have in the 21st century. And so if we want to, you know, we're fighting so hard for parity at work. You know, we're fighting so hard to make sure that we have equal representation in every industry. Let's make sure that we don't close ourselves out of this one, because this is going to be it.
At what age do you think that interest in computer science peaks for girls?
Around eighth grade. You know, I have a bunch, we're teaching a bunch, we just launched third to fifth grade clubs, and oh my God, they're so geeked out. They're so excited. They don't have that, oh, you know, this isn't cool. Or, oh, the boy, you know, it's all for boys and nerdy boys. Like, they don't have all that stuff. And it's not their fault. It's culture. You know, we had a Barbie doll that said, I hate math. Let's go shopping instead. Mm-hmm. You know, you can buy a T-shirt at Forever 21 that says I'm allergic to algebra. I mean, there are so many messages everywhere, right?
Yeah.
And so we shouldn't be surprised. And I think the older girls get, the more they pick up on these things.
In researching for the book, you did hundreds of interviews, and I would love to hear what some of the more unique practices were that you heard about that women had to be brave.
You know, one of the things I thought that was so important was this idea, and Arianna Huffington talked about this, is that you can't be brave if you're tired. And that so much of creating a bravery mindset is getting enough rest, you know, is eating well.
Yeah.
You know, is making sure, right, that you have time for yourself. And oftentimes, do you know how many women, you know, we know they need to make a doctor's appointment, haven't had a checkup in years, and feel like it's too selfish to go to the doctor?
Yeah.
And so to me, it's like basic 101, take care of yourself. I cannot expect you to be brave if you're exhausted. You know, that to me is really important. I think the second idea, we talked to a lot of athletes, and it was interesting to me that so many of them were like, I'm not a perfectionist. Like, you know what I mean? I'm not worried about that. And it's this idea that, like, you know, when you're an athlete, you are always sitting on the edge of like critical feedback. You know what I mean? And you're having a coach who's sitting there saying, and your ability, right? Your critical feedback and your ability. And so you're having a coach who's sitting there saying, do it again, do it again, do it again. Not good. You know, and mm-hmm. So you don't take that feedback personally because you want to be great. And so far too often we take feedback personally. We think it's about us because we haven't heard critical feedback for much of our life. And for many young women, it's not until they get their first job. And so to me, how do you constantly put yourself in a position where you're getting that kind of feedback? You know, my husband always teases me, but he knows, like, if I give a speech and he's there, I'm always like, rate me. How was I? And he knows not to give me a 10. You know what I mean? And there are times, and I talk about this in my book, how like I was giving a speech right after someone who had like beaten me in an election. And so it was a sore spot. My son was there. It was raining. He was like tugging on my dress. And, you know, I sucked and I knew I sucked. And I got in that car and he could have just said, oh, honey, you were great. Because he knew how I was, you know, the insecurity that I was feeling at that moment. But he was like, you sucked. And I was happy to hear it because I want to get better.
Wow. You know, another interesting thing that you say in the book is that when girls speak up for themselves, they can be seen as pushy and unlikable. Why is that the case? And why aren't men seen the same way?
Well, because I think that we, from the beginning, are taught to be likable. I have this great story in the book about lemonade. And, you know, they had done a study on, you know, five and six-year-olds about lemonade, and they had spiked the lemonade with salt instead of sugar. And so when the boys drank it, they're like, ugh, this is gross, nasty, right? And when the girl, when the girls drank it, they're like, oh, this is delicious. I mean, maybe a little bit more, you know, they're worried about her feeling.
Yeah.
And they didn't want to make her feel bad. And the boys didn't care. And so it's from the time that we are raised, right? We tell our girls, go give her a hug and a kiss. Tell her thank you. Don't take that toy away from her, right? We're constantly taught to think about others and about how other people feel. And so when we see a woman not behaving that way, it's almost like a turnoff, right? Whereas when we see a man doing that, it's expected. And so that's why it's like, it's not going to be easy to change this. And it can't be one person at a time. Like, we all have to, like, basically stop doing this toxic people-pleasing and tell people what we really think.
So what is the very most important message that you want people to get from Brave Not Perfect? It's a great book, by the way.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think that this isn't a management book. This is a life book. Uh-huh. I want you to be brave because I want you to be joyful in your life.
Right. It's not just about success. It's about joy. No. It really is about joy more than success, if anything.
Yeah, it is. And I feel this about my own life. Like, I'm not satisfied yet with what I've done, but I'm at peace. And I'm at peace because when I lost that race, I knew what it was like to stop. I knew what it was like to start putting my dreams first and start being honest with myself and not being scared to take a risk. And so even if things don't work out, I don't feel that regret and that sense of doom and that sense of, like, doom about my life. Like, I'm happy and joyful that I'm trying.
Who are the role models that you look up to? Who are the people you admire?
So many of the women that are my friends in my life, that are my peers. I mean, so many girls that I see every day that are just, I had one of my students and, you know, my husband in email being like, my husband's an investor. And she was like, your wife taught me how to code and you're going to hire me to invest. Like, and it was just so awesome. Right. You know, I just see my girls just doing really brave things and hard things. And a lot of them come from really hard circumstances, but they're not giving up. You know, they're fighting for their opportunity. And they're fighting for their chance to make a difference. And I'm just inspired by that every day.
Reshma, as you know, our show is called Nobody Told Me. And at the end of each show, we ask our guests, what is your nobody told me lesson? So what do you wish that somebody had told you that would have helped you avoid some of the pitfalls?
Nobody told me that I didn't have to be perfect.
Wow, that's succinct.
That really says it all
like
right
that.
There.
Yeah. Yeah, it really does. It really does. And, you know, the other question I really want to ask you is, what advice would you have for a girl who wants to start on the pathway to a career in computer science? Give us a little bit of a roadmap for her.
I would say just start. Do one thing. You know, whether it's getting on, you know, Khan Academy and practicing Scratch, whether it's joining your local Girls Who Code club, you know, whether it's going to a maker fair, just start.
And how can people connect with you on social media and learn more about the book and about Girls Who Code?
Sure. Go to my website, ReshmaSaujani.com. You know, follow me on Twitter or Instagram at ReshmaSaujani. And if you want to learn more about Girls Who Code, either go to my website or go to GirlsWhoCode.com.
All right. Sounds good. Thank you so much for joining us, Reshma.
Thank you. This was a great conversation. Thank you, guys.
This was a lot of fun. And happy birthday to your son.
Thank you. I'll let him know.
Okay. Our thanks to Reshma Saujani, whose book, her new book is Brave, Not Perfect, Fear Less, Fail More, and Live Bolder. I'm Jan Black.
And I'm Laura Owens.
You're listening to Nobody Told Me. Thank you so much for joining us.